discussion. Thank you for hearing.
Yes, please. Yes, sir. Please. Yeah, we can start.
See, I've been watching the TV debates in the legislative side. There's something that is talked all the time, four times. Actually, that's a bad misnomer because the basic price that has been actually prescribed in the registration point when you sell an ad. Is what is the government's fix. For example, you know, the black money which is actually, if you want to sell or buy a land or a house, there is a bare minimum for registration, and that registration only is what is put in. And four times of that is given, which is much less than the market price. So this is something which is, you know, they forcefully tell, oh, four times they are given. This is actually very humbug, that number one. Second thing, I myself have some land around Bangalore. And that is, you know, the most of it has been acquired for the peripheral road. Okay. Now, the normal tendency in the 1894 Act when government, one thing good about, at least one thing good about the earlier Act was the government for the government purposes, which is now completely going away. Now, the peripheral road in Bangalore, which is 133 kilometers, every 12 kilometers that they acquire another 12 acres of land. You see, originally 100 meters were to be acquired around this peripheral road. You know, this is the inner circle, inner ring road. There is something called peripheral ring road, which is 133 kilometers around this place. And now they try to acquire 100 meters. It was too much. Okay, then finally it went to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court actually said you can acquire at best what you need, 25 meters will be left to the farmer, etc., which is developed. It is actually stalled because of the same legislation, because now they don't know how to give compensation. And now the basic problem in land acquisition, which is actually important to note, they notify it. And called 4-1 notification, 5-1 notification, 6-1 notification. My land has been going in the notification for 14 years. And you cannot sell anything, you cannot do anything, I am becoming old, and the compensation will come after I am dead. In literature. Because 14 years are over, another 14 years I won't be surviving. I am 69. And therefore it is meaningless. So, and you can't do anything with it because in the record of the land, it is notified. And therefore you cannot sell it, you cannot do anything with it. This is another thing which is actually happening in the government. So far as the present, this one I want to ask you. See, it is blatantly Modi government is talking. I'll give you one illustration to you. Take Bangalore-Mysore corridor, okay, which is all valuable land. Alright? Now 1 kilometer left and right. What are they talking? I have heard Gadkari, which is absolutely absolutely cheating in my mind. I was sitting quietly, seeing the TV. He says, industry. Which industry they are talking about? Which particular kind of jobs they are creating? What is that? Is it put like, what is the amount of land that you need for a small industry around the village? First of all, there are no industry that has come ever since what you are talking around the village. You can take my word. Because I come from a village and I have seen for 100 years, 60 years myself, I have seen nothing comes. Okay. Now, the main value of the land is only for the selling. In fact, you know, I should not use this word when Rawalgarhi intervened in the government. He said, you buy by acres and sell by square. That's exactly happening. Okay. So, they actually buy by acres, kilometers and sell by. And it's extremely bad now. And unless something happens, it will be a very, very ruining thing. And also this has got another implication, that is, you see, the people who have money will acquire, keep it, and till the land price comes. And so the poorer person, like some who doesn't have land, cannot buy a land for building houses at a cheaper rate. Presently it is not so, because you can go bilateral, you can find out whatever the market price at least you can buy. But if that option will go away, because there is no land to buy, because you know it will be mass acquire. in the, see, once government comes into picture, the danger is that, you cannot revert it. You cannot do anything. And it will be in the hands of the private public, whatever they are talking, at a very dominating thing. So I think this is the thing that I think something more you should do. I think there is a huge advantage for the organized that you are talking, because the innocence of the farmers, innocence of the poor people, helplessness of the poor people has been attacked. This is something which is important for people. Thank you.
Before I go to the next question, I request you to be mindful of a bit of time so that you can ask some shorter questions. I have some questions that I wrote myself. So even in the, when working in farmlands, there will be a hierarchy in the rural employment. There will be a landlord as well as agricultural laborers and other dependents. So how does this compensation and rehabilitation, how is it different for all of them? Is it the same for all of them, or has it been changed?
I don't think that is a point, because you know, land owner is owner, right? There is nothing like for the owner.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I think I'll take more questions.
Okay.
Sir, I had one question and one problem, sir. First question is, could I know that under what conditions government should impose this land acquisition bill? This is my question, sir.
And under what conditions?
Under what conditions this government should impose this land acquisition bill? And my problem is, in villages, sir, people, some, they are doing their agriculture from 20, 30 years and sir. And they, in rural areas, they are doing agriculture in forest areas only, sir, forest places only. So they don't have their land papers also. So now, Telangana government is saying that taking back their lands, their living places also. Then what is the solution for this problem?
So I wanted to ask, what about like the owner having a part in the project? Like the not considering the value of the land, he has a fixed part in the project, like 5% of the value of the project or whatsoever. Then if he wants to take the money by selling it, it's up to him.
One question I had was, as sir has pointed out, what's the procedure for fixing the price of land? If the government itself is involved, then can we expect it to be reasonable? And since the bill, I don't think farmers have negotiating, you know, share at the table.
Yes.
To, if the government itself is fixing it, so will it ever be, you know, justified for the
any hope?
You talked something about some 70-80% consent in some sort of way. Can you keep more elaborate? Like, is it the consent or some other consent? How is it 70-80%?
Okay.
And one question I had was, the earlier Act 2013 excluded private hospitals and education institutes. But this law, this amendment conveniently includes. Can you guess why the government is doing that? Can there be any good intention behind that?
Regarding that compensation, you told that one person will be given the job. So my question is it something proportional to the land that is being acquired, or any amount of land?
My question regards the capital region development analysis in Andhra Pradesh.
Capital region.
Yes, that has come up recently after the region of Andhra Pradesh. So there, the government is planning to acquire full the land from 29 villages. It's an agricultural land, multiple of that. And there the main issue which I found is that most of the farmers who are willing to give the land are the owners who own more than say 10 acres of land, who will not be affected directly by the good, but the small farmers are the ones who are in the market, who are minority members are being affected, and how do we tackle this kind of issue?
One last question is, I mean, the amendments are so radical that they would exempt even the consent of the farmers at all completely, for 5%. One obvious thing to have is that constitutionally valid at all. Right to property has to be one of the fundamental tenets of our constitution. So, can this be, I guess the court will drag it long enough, but at least in the legal recourse, if, say, association of farmers decide to go for it. Anything else?
Okay, maybe I'll address this and then firstly, what sir mentioned here, perfectly correct about compensation. When the first draft of this bill was brought by Chairman Ramesh, it mentioned 6 times compensation. Then they reduced it to 4 times for rural areas.
And when we were discussing in our organization, farmer friends from states like Tamil Nadu said, even 10 times, that still we will not get a proper price. Because the price is undervalued and according to the registration and according to the government records. So that is perfectly correct what you have. And we did bring it to the notice. We had mentioned that there should be some kind of a, the local self-governing and some kind of a consultation process with the people there, and that way you should arrive at a compensation which can be. And you mentioned about the Bangalore-Mysore corridor, the nice road and such things. We have also been taking up these issues and fighting, and we have also seen how
the regular road,
yeah.
Now they want to expand.
The question is, it doesn't matter where. Wherever there is a value, you want to acquire. That's the whole point.
That is the.
It is nothing to do with nicer. Exactly. And people who are having money are acquiring money and political clout. Because if you see the report which the Karnataka government had set in an inquiry, maximum land grabbing has been done by people who are sitting and deciding the legislations for our state here. That is one thing. And another is regarding the hierarchy in land relations. Yes, the hierarchy in land relations, what happens is the answer to a certain extent is there in this question about land being pooled for the capital in Andhra Pradesh from 27 villages. Apparently, it is something like 7,000 square kilometer area that is being taken. And there, you have many non-cultivating households. They are holding land. Many of them, their family, the children are in US or somewhere abroad. And since they are upward, there has been an upward mobility, they are mostly residing in Hyderabad or some other cities. And some of them even coming to Raichur and all that in, into cultivation in a big way. So here the land is being actually leased out to poor tenants, agriculture workers. In fact, now there is no protection for any of them. Just on the way to IAC, I got a call from a Supreme Court lawyer who said there are farmers and tenant farmers from this area who want to meet us in Delhi in the next week, because they feel none of the major political parties there have taken up this issue so far. So these hierarchies are there, and that is when the agriculture worker, whatever they are providing is for one job per family.
Yes,
it is, and there is, it is only the land owner who has the, and that is where this question is important. In Karnataka, you are talking about Telangana. In Karnataka, there are about 20 lakh forest land cultivators. People having half an acre, 1 acre, below 10 acres in any case. And by this latest ordinance, they have also brought in that state governments should make a survey of government lands. So, make a survey implies that those who are occupying those lands without pattas should be evicted from it. And the Karnataka government, it is a Congress-led government, They have already started some process in this direction. Telangana is a the Telangana Rashtra is ruling there. They have also come up with similar steps. It is happening in other places too. Under what conditions the government should impose land acquisition? I think we, what we are saying is it should not be imposed firstly. And if it should be, if there should be land acquisition for some project, then the principle of prior informed consent, the concern of the safeguard for food security, the social impact assessment, these should surely be taken into
account.
Yeah.
See, public purpose, public cause, like railway, etc.
Yeah.
There is no consent required.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
And therefore, government can take only for public purposes when it is specified that consent is not required. For all other purposes is what the consent was.
Yeah, but what I am telling is, lot of projects, now they have exempted in the name of national security and so on.
But that should all go.
Yeah. Yeah. That, that, that is what we are saying.
Absolutely.
And also we say that there should be a national and state land use commission or land use board in which will have a proper land use plan at the state and national level. So you see, last the multi-cropped area which they were talking about in the last act, they were saying, you know, 5% of the land in a district can be acquired. So, okay, 5% of the multi-crop land is acquired and already cultivated. Then again you have multi-crop land, again that 5%, in effect, in a gradual way you can occupy it. That is, if you just try to extrapolate a bit, then it can happen. So, there is, we were not happy with even that provision. We had more stringent provisions in our suggestions. Owner having a stake in project, this is something which organizations have raised. Unfortunately, the government has only said something like some annuity, some minimal amount on a regular basis, that is for few years would be given and so on. They have not accepted this particular thing. The issue of 70% or 80% concern. The earlier thing was for a government purpose, that is a public purpose if you are taking land, then 70% consent of all people in that area should be taken into account, wherever the land. And for a public-private partnership project, 80% of the consent should be taken into account. That was the, and here how we were in some, the earlier act was talking about especially the scheduled areas, the tribal areas, that it should be just based on whatever the panchayat takes. We were of the opinion, the Gram Sabha, because there is the panchayat extension to scheduled areas, the pesas has certain specific regulations, and under the Forest Rights Act also there are some protection for these areas that should be maintained, but the government has not been in a mood to accept it. And one person job, is it proportional to the land acquired? No, it is not. It is. They have just mentioned about it, that whichever families, especially the agriculture workers families are involved, their one person would be given. But then what about the artisans who are there? What about the, even the farmer families itself? What about their jobs? That is also not very clear in this land ordinance which has come up here. Whether legally we can question on this concept, I think some groups are planning for filing a PIL into this issue, but we are trying to look into
different possibilities, mobilizing on the ground level, in the parliament, the legal recourse, and they are also prepared of that this government will push through this bill, and wherever unjust acquisition is going on, whatever way possible, we will be there. And that we have our own, not everywhere that the Kisan Sabha, we have our own 2 crore members across the country. We are trying to educate the farming community, the agriculture workers about their rights. So that is also.
I would like to also bring to your notice some figures.
Sir, I have got three important questions.
Yeah.
One, after the 2013 Act, were there acquisitions at all under that law? After the ordinance, of the two ordinances that we can get to, were there any acquisitions? Second question. Third, was the 2013 Act was reasonably satisfactory for the taxes?
To my best knowledge, whatever acquisitions were have been happening have still been going on by the 1894 Act.
But after the new law comes, they should have been full.
And that is after the 2013 Act came into being. I don't think anywhere an acquisition has happened under this particular Act. Though, because that called for consent, seeking the consent and so on, it has never, there has been no such process. To my best knowledge, I can stand correct. The second thing you asked is, you...
After the ordinance, were there any improvements?
No, it is the same. And the third...
What the 2013 Act is reasonably good? For the overall, you know, after all, you know...
In relation to the what this government is trying to bring, which
is... Both way, in relation to 1890...
No, in relation to the whatever the Modi government is trying to bring, it is surely far better. In relation to the 1894 Act, also it is better because the people's consent is sought. And these kind of issues are.
I think I got it.
But we have our opposition to many issues. That is, I am saying it is surely better. It is a step forward in the right direction. And I would like to bring to your notice some other numbers. According to the CAG report recently, for SEZs, you know, in a country like China, apparently it is about 6 SEZs, which a few years back this was the biggest, it might have increased it a little more. In India, there are about 560 SEZs which have been. And out of these, a total of 45,635 hectares of SEZ land was allotted in 2014, in which work has begun only in 28,488 hectares. And in 17 states, gross violation of the land acquired for some reason, being utilized for probably different reason. In Odisha, for instance, 96.58% of the SEZ land remained unutilized. And over 75,000 crore was raised just by mortgaging this land by these big corporate companies. One question was there about educational institutions and hospitals, private hospitals. You see, in the Delhi, I am not recollecting whether it is the Fortis or the Escorts group. One of them, they sought land almost without having to pay anything or building a hospital on the pretext that they would give subsidized or free treatment to the poor. Once the land was built and the land was given and the hospital built, now they are saying we cannot give it at subsidized rate. The land was given, it seems something like 1 rupee per acre, something like that. And now they are saying that it cannot be, that you cannot provide health services at a subsidized rate. Some of our friends have gone to court against that. In many of these private hospitals and educational institutions, you see, for instance, the Vedanta University in Orissa, which was banned, is spread across around 6,000 acres. A university like JNU has just 1000 acres, of which 60% of it is still forest land. So you can, it is anybody's guess why this much land of prime area in the coastal regions, this land is being acquired and in the name of tourism, data promotion, some hotels coming up, and these kind of misuse for other purposes very much there. There is also another issue which I would like to bring to your notice. There is this Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor. That will pass across six states. We are fighting against this Bangalore-Mysore. So this is six states, and we made a calculation that if 1 kilometer on both sides are taken, then it would mean almost 7 lakh square kilometer or 17.5% of all agriculture land in this country would be open for acquisition. So that is the nature of acquisition this government is talking about. And we have all been hearing about smart cities. Here, sitting here, I would just like to ask a question back to you. Anyone here who knows where Senapati is located? It's a place. Senapati is a place where it is located. It can, even a guest can. Is okay. No. It is a place located in Manipur. And one of the smart cities, 100 smart cities, is supposedly coming there. If you take the Indian census, below there will be an asterisk and below there will be a footnote which says, Senapati, there has been no census in Senapati. For whatever reasons, we are not having census in Senapati. One smart city is supposedly coming there. And that is predominantly tribal who are into the June cultivation, shifting cultivation. And who is going to be there? It is going to lead to extreme social tensions in coming days. And it will just blow up in the face of the ruling class. Whether organizations like Kisan Sabha will be in the forefront of leading that struggle or spontaneous. Whether we are there or not, people are going to resist it. That is 100 smart cities. And who is wanting to come here? If you see the Modi government or the BJP, RSS, they have been making so much campaign against China. Their entire, how the ultra-nationalist campaign which is there about the China border issue, we have always seen. Now there is so much interest in China. There is a talk of a Bangladesh-Myanmar industrial corridor, Myanmar-India-China industry. So from Kunming in China to Calcutta, there will be an industrial corridor. And in India, with this condition that you can take 1 kilometer on both sides, if Modi is thinking that the people are just going to accept his Mann Ki Baat speeches, he is very much mistaken. I have just returned from Haryana. Haryana has just elected a BJP government for the first time. Sitting in BJP houses which sport the BJP flag, they have had meetings about the problems that they are facing. This is going to surely blow up in their face, and come what may, it will have its own electoral and other repercussions too. One thing I would also like to mention, there is this talk about how development is required. Development for whom and all those debates are there, and what kind of development is also there. Another thing they say, educated people should have jobs. Obviously, there should be opportunities of employment for those who are getting educated. But if you see the kind of exaggerated claims that they make, and the POSCO project was being spoken about, the POSCO claimed that of the 9.9 lakh unemployed in Odisha, about 8 lakh would get job because of the POSCO. So it would almost eliminate unemployment. This from initial days we are talking about employment generation, but it is such a solution, some kind of a final solution that they are mentioning. And according to the study by the mining zone people solidarity group, if not even 50,000 jobs have been created. So that is the kind of displacement and dispossession which these policies are going to bring in. And why the government is keen on it, there is a particular reason. They are talking about Make in India. Make in India, who will make in India, for whom they will make is also being debated. They want the cheap labor of the corporate who are in a perpetual state of insecurity, who are migrating in search of jobs. That is one thing. If you see that some of these, they write very without any hesitation. The Karnataka government under the Yediyurappa regime, we had an integrated agri-business development plan. It mentioned about how agri-tourism would be promoted. I might have said this before also in my talk here. It says up to 2,000 acres can be taken in the name of agri-tourism, and you can have what would have, what was it that they are envisaging as agri-tourism? Bullock cart riding and feeding of cows and goats. It is written in a government document. And the chairman, the deputy chairman of the Niti Aayog, Arvind Pandya, has said how agriculture cannot provide jobs. It is not contributing to GDP. So you have to go into industrialization. Farmers are committing suicide across the country, and government, the ministers are saying that they are cowards or they are criminals who are committing suicide. But it is the government policy which is given. So the entire neoliberal policies is aimed at dispossessing the peasantry and creating a large insecure reserve army of labor. They also have an answer when you ask about how food security concerns can be addressed. They say we can shop land abroad in the internal talks. So you can go to Ethiopia and Latin American countries, sub-Saharan African countries, and this set of insecure reserve army of labor can be used by the companies there. That is the, though they have not yet stated, it is some kind of indentured labor which during the British period they were trying, they were taking. You have Indian laborers who have gone to Australia, to Fiji, to Canada, everywhere. It is some, to Thailand and many other places. So it is quickly moving in that direction. But the ruling classes are mistaken. It is going to be met with very stiff resistance, and that will change the course. Anything more? Any more questions?
One small clarification. When you talk about public, or these PPPs and... So when we talk about PPPs and just public projects, right? So can you elaborate on what they actually mean? So would roads come under PPPs or they come under public projects?
Most of the roads, now they have given to PPP, the public-private partnership. So, and the government in their explanation of public purpose, roads and such infrastructure has been treated as public purpose. And PPP projects, if you take a, let us say, any flyover, which is, I had a friend who was working with the National Highway Authority, a senior engineer, who twice came out to us telling, this is the biggest corruption that is going on. Firstly, the companies claim that this project is not viable. So, to fill that viability gap, there is something called viability gap money which is given by the government. Apparently, most of these projects are competed by just this viability gap money which they get.
I want to point out to you in the answer of this also, or you can answer me. See, it is a mistaken notion that only roads are built. I come from a village, I come from many places. In fact, connectivity in terms of the road or the place is already there as the what you call kharab, etc. Maybe a small extension around that place is all that is called for, which is very, very fact is that it's all people who do not know. They think they are greedy. Third thing which I want to mention is, what is that they are trying to, which industry they are talking? What is that they are making? Make in India, what is that they make? We have no hope. What is that they are talking? Which industry they are coming for? I also want to ask you another question. There was a bogey of, you know, like Infosys, etc., they were getting large check government is. That somehow got banned, is it correct?
Large?
See, because yes, you know, about 4 years ago in the Edinburgh time, etc., they were all gathering, giving them the land, the free land. You know, they were actually trying to become big land owners. But that did not happen, if I'm correct, is it correct?
Yeah, there was, firstly, let me address this question. Model. So with this viability gap removed itself, apparently the construction they manage in most sense. Then the actual cost of the construction is also taken over by the from the government. That is what. And then you have the toll collection. If anyone can make a study of the toll collected in a year from any of these projects here. Apparently, that will unravel what is the level of corruption. So that is the kind of as far as PPP model is.
So kind of building on that, are there actually any public projects at all?
No, actually you see, in the neoliberal phase, that is from 1991 onwards, what we find increasingly the state is withdrawn. And state, the minimum is the state. These kind of arguments used to be there before, where state should be only looking into law and order, nothing more. And we are fast moving in that direction. So you have public sector undertakings, profit making public sector undertakings being just sold off to private companies. We have, in agriculture itself, we have the case of fertilizer companies. We have many fertilizer companies, which was just closed up. The argument was, we will get cheaper fertilizers and better fertilizers from abroad. Right. But when a country of India's magnitude, with crores of farmers, goes to the international market, that itself leads to an increase in prices. Because the possibility of this market is low. Now, for instance, phosphates. We are entirely dependent on China and Morocco for phosphates. Forget the border question. If China says we won't give phosphates to India from now, that itself will lead to a big problem for crisis for the countries. And even phosphates, how the countries are benefiting from it. Phosphate from China is being, in 2012-13, was ranging around $450 to $500 per ton. Our government gives around $230 per ton as subsidy to Adani's, Ambani's and Tata, Reliance. These are some of the, and Birla, these are the companies which import this phosphates. So in effect, they are not paying more than $270 per ton of diammonium phosphate. Our farmers are paying more than $600. No one has so far said this is corruption. It just happens. No anti-corruption crusader. We have been raising, and to be fair to the last CAG, he also in his report details about how fertilizer, the corruption fertilizers. So that is the.
Just on that, so subsidies are homogeneous, right? So how can we? Some of the company groups can benefit from that sort of subsidy on phosphates and not the farmers in particular.
No, you see, earlier when the subsidy was given, the government was fixing the price. So what happens? If there is a change in the international market price, so according to the fluctuation in the market price, the subsidy is also used to increase. So let us say, in a year, if the lowest subsidy given per ton was something like 6,000, the highest subsidy would be something like 56,000. I'm just giving an example. That is, according to the increase in the price in the international market, the subsidy also would rise. So what happened? The price is fixed by the government with a reasonable amount of profit for the company. But from the last from 2010 onwards, the farm gate price is determined by the company. So they are honoring the subsidy, they are also determining the prices. There is no price control by the government. So that is how the government is withdrawing from all these sections. Anything more? If not, I think I'll. Any more questions? I think I'll just conclude by saying the role of people sitting here in countering the campaign of the present government is that they are using all kinds of mechanisms, social media in a big way, they are using the big media houses for their campaigns, a lot of advertisements from the side of government. I think need not necessarily be just by listening to me, but you also trying to understand more about some of these, what is the reality. It would be good if you can play your own humble role in countering this campaign. It will help the peasant movement as well as the people, poor people across the country in a big way. Thank you all.
Part of the entire